In Revelation chapter 1 and verse 9, John says, I, John, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation and in the kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was in the isle that is called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day and heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet saying, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. And what thou seest, write in a book and send it unto the seven churches which are in Asia. Did any church who received that letter wonder what day that was, the Lord's day? Did they wonder what that was and what that meant? No, they knew very clearly what that meant. There's a lot of things that the early church believed and did that had generation after generation educated their people properly, there wouldn't be the questions and the heresies that we have today. The problem is, people oftentimes go along with something and not know why they did it. And then after a few generations, Satan challenges it or introduces an error and they can't answer it because they haven't been educating themselves along the way. The head covering is a prime example of that. And you've got, and it's amazing to me when I first started looking into it, how many people thought this was a symbol of authority, this was a prayer veil, all these different ideas. It's like that wasn't the original idea. And yet they come up with these things because when it gets challenged, they haven't educated each generation along the way, so they don't know why they do it. You know? Why do we cut this side of the ham off? Well, because grandma did. Well, why did grandma do it? Well, because great-grandma did. Well, why did great-grandma do it? Well, her pot was too small. But we're still doing it even though we have a bigger pot. Mm-hmm. Just because grandma did it. We need to be educated. So, what day is the Lord's day? Some in our day would say, well, of course, no kidding, it's a Sabbath. And then others would say, no, it's the resurrection day. Well, can we know? Well, if you pay attention, I think you will know when we get done here. The word Lord's, the Lord's day, that word Lord's in the Greek is only two times present in our scriptures. It's the word Kyriakos. It occurs here in Revelation 1:9, and it occurs in 1 Corinthians 11:20, when it says, when you come together, therefore, into one place, this is not to eat the Lord's Supper. The Lord's Day and the Lord's Supper. That's the only two times that word occurs. And we know that the Lord's Supper is the supper established and instituted by the Lord Jesus. That was what it referred to. And I proposed to you this morning that when the early Christians read the Lord's Day, they also understood that it was the day that the Lord had made. Okay? How does the Lord make a day? Obviously, he made all the days. And obviously, that's not what we're talking about. We're not talking about creating a day. We're talking about establishing a specialness about a day. Okay? So, that verse right there has a context, and we'll look at it in a little bit. So, what is the testimony of the New Testament concerning this issue of the Lord's Day versus the Sabbath day? Well, slide number one. Number one, Jesus chose Sunday for his triumphal entry into Jerusalem, Nisan 10. It's what we know as Palm Sunday, okay? And I want you to notice that in these great feasts that represented the new covenant coming, the Messiah and what he would do in the plan of redemption, the first day of the week is very prominent and very important. So in Exodus 12:1, we find that they were instructed in Egypt in the 10th day of the month. And by the way, God gave them a new beginning of months, a new year at this time as well. But he said, on the 10th of this month, which was Nisan, in fact, originally it was called Abib, because after the carrying away to Babylon that Nisan became established. So if you read that, don't get confused. Abib and Nisan are the same thing. So he says here, this month should be to you a beginning of months. It should be the first month of the year to you. Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month, they shall take to them every man a lamb, according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. And if the household be too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next unto his house take it according to the number of the souls. Every man according to his eating shall make your account for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You shall take it out of from the sheep or from the goats, and you shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same month, and the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening. This was done 1,500 years plus before Christ fulfilled this. So we have here, they take this lamb out of the flock. They were supposed to have it. They were supposed to observe it. They were supposed to make sure it was without blemish. Now, it is generally believed that Israel did not do this every Passover after this. They only did it at this time. I don't know that that's accurate or not, but that's what most scholars think and what the Jews actually say, that this was the only time they did this. Regardless of that, it was part of the original type, and it was very important, okay? obviously, after this same original Passover, they didn't put the blood on the doorposts either, and they didn't eat it standing up with their shoes on ready to go and all that sort of thing. So the feast became a remembrance of this feast, okay? Just like when we celebrate the Resurrection Day, we're not celebrating so much the date, the 17th of Nisan. We're celebrating that particular Nisan 17 in AD 30, which was on Sunday. Nisan 17 is not always on Sunday. It changes throughout every year, just like other holidays where we go by the date instead of the day. But we're not celebrating the date. We're celebrating the day that it happened in AD 30. So the same with Passover. They were celebrating and remembering this original Passover, but they were doing it on the date of the time that it happened here. There wasn't no particular day, but the date, the 10th and the 14th, were prominent. And God was setting that up because in the Passover, when Jesus fulfilled it as the Lamb of God, the day was also significant that time. Okay? And we'll see that. So, number two, Jesus rose on the first day of the week. So the triumphal entry, Nisan 10, Jesus comes into Jerusalem. They're saying, Hosanna to the King of the Son of David, and Hosanna to the Messiah. And he's coming in riding on a donkey as the King of Israel. That was Palm Sunday. That was the 10th. On the 14th day was Thursday, and that's when he was arrested that evening. He was given the death sentence Thursday night. The crucifixion didn't happen until Friday, but he was given the death sentence Thursday night. And then number two, Jesus rose on the first day of the week, Nisan 17. It was the Feast of First Fruits. The Feast of First Fruits was always the morrow after the Sabbath of Passover. So the Feast of First Fruits would always be on a Sunday. Because the Passover, the Sabbath of Passover, then there was always the next day was the 17th, okay? So the day became significant. Jesus rose the first day of the week. It says in Mark 16:9, now when Jesus was risen early the first day of the week. I want you to notice something in these next two passages. The Sabbatarians always try to question whether Jesus rose early Sunday morning or Saturday evening, because after all, the Jews began their day in the evening and not the morning. And so, but I want you to see here that that's not consistent.
Right.
They didn't always do that. And here we can see Jesus rose early the first day of the week. Matthew 28:1, in the end of the Sabbath as it began to dawn. Okay? So don't tell me they always consistently stated that their day began at evening. They didn't always consistently do that. And then Mary Magdalene and them came to the sepulcher. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week. John 20:19. Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week. He didn't say, now the second day of the week's begun. It's evening though. Okay, so see there that it's not consistently stated. And you can't change the obvious for something like, well, no, they began their day at the evening. They didn't always. And if you talk to a Sabbatarian, that will come up, and you can just tell them that's not concrete, okay? The same day at even being the first day of the week. We know the same day means the same day he rose from the dead. Mm-hmm. All right? They were on the road to Emmaus that evening, that same day, and it was evening, and they said it was still the first day of the week. So, number one, the triumphal entry was on Sunday. Number two, Jesus rose from the dead on Sunday, the first day of the week. It doesn't matter. They say, well, you know, these were sun worshipers, so the Pope changed it to Sunday because he was a sun worshiper. Okay, so are you a Saturn worshiper? Is that why you want Saturday? The name of the day means nothing in this regard, okay? This is something totally different. The Pope didn't change it. That's a bunch of nonsense. What you'll find in Seventh-day Adventist literature, you'll find quotes from early church writings that say the day was changed by the Catholic Church. And Seventh-day Adventists immediately think Roman Catholic, Pope. Understand that the early church writers used the word Catholic for the universal, commonly accepted scriptures, the Catholic scriptures, the universal, commonly accepted faith, the Catholic faith. It doesn't mean the Romanists. It doesn't mean the Pope of Rome. It was before that ever began. All right? So when you read Seventh-day Adventist literature, don't be drawn into that assumption, okay? The word Catholic doesn't always mean what it means today. So number three, Christ appeared to his disciples on the first day of the week. He rose the first day of the week, and the next first day of the week, the next Sunday, he appeared to them again. It says in John 20:26, and after 8 days again, his disciples were within and Thomas with them. Then came Jesus, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst and said, peace be unto you. Why did he wait a whole week? Why did he meet with them on the first day of the week and then wait from the 17th all the way to the 24th to meet with them again? There's a purpose here, all right? This day that the Lord is making special, it's a day the Lord has made, and we're not done yet. There's a lot more going on this day. The term the eighth day was a term that came from the law. They had a feast on the first day and the eighth day, and it became known as a term meaning a week from today or the first day of the week, and it was the morrow after the Sabbath. So the Sabbath was the seventh day. It would be called the eighth day. They didn't always say the first day of the week. Sometimes they said the eighth day, and everybody knew what they meant. They meant the first day of the week. So it became known as such. Number three, Christ appeared to his disciples after his resurrection on the first day of the week. Number four, Pentecost was on the first day of the week. And the Bible designates this specifically because it says here, and ye shall count unto you from the morrow after the Sabbath. The morrow after the Sabbath of Passover. All right? You shall number to you from the day that ye brought the sheaf of the wave offering. The Feast of First Fruits, when they waved the sheaf openly, they didn't know what they were doing. But God resurrected Christ and showed him openly to witnesses, all right? And so the Feast of First Fruits was talking about the resurrection. Christ was called the first fruits of the resurrection. And so the Feast of First Fruits was always the morrow after the Sabbath of Passover. Now, there have been people who have, actually the Jews today have changed that. But if you go to this verse, it's plain as day, and just because somebody changed it and wants to go by the day after the 14th or whatever, and instead of the day, they can change it all they want. But the fact is, it's very clear in Leviticus 23:15 that you count from the morrow after the Sabbath of Passover, and you count seven Sabbaths. Okay, those seven Sabbaths are Saturdays. Nobody can deny that. After seven Sabbaths should be complete, even on the morrow after the seventh Sabbath. That's going to be on a Sunday. Mm-hmm. Okay? So, if that's so, then the morrow after the Sabbath in the Passover was also Sunday. And we're not just talking about the day after the 14th. We're talking about the Sabbath of Passover. The Sabbath that fell during Passover week, you always went to the morrow after that, which was always Sunday. All right? Now, if you read stuff about it, you'll find out there's other people who try to do other things with it. I'm just telling you what is clearly obvious from Scripture. Those seven Sabbaths, say, if they want to make, okay, if they want to make the Sabbath of Passover the day after the 14th, which would be maybe on a Thursday, they all admit that those seven Sabbaths are Saturdays. Mm-hmm. Okay? Yep. So there's no reason to mess with the Passover. We're talking about the Saturday Sabbath of Passover. The morrow after is Sunday. And then you count seven Sabbaths from there to the morrow after the seventh Sabbath, which is 50 days. The word Pentecost means 50 days. All right? And so that day was always the first day of the week. God designated this 1,500 years before Christ came. There is a specialness prefigured here that's going to be fulfilled in the plan of redemption, the Passover, the resurrection, the pouring out of the Holy Spirit. When the Jews celebrated these things, they were remembering Egypt, Mount Sinai. Passover was how they came out of Egypt, and Pentecost was the giving of the law on Mount Sinai. What they didn't understand is there was a bigger Passover and a bigger Sinai coming in the future when God the Messiah would come and be the Lamb of God, resurrect on the Feast of First Fruits, and then the Holy Ghost would be poured out on Pentecost to write God's law in our hearts and not just on tables of stone. So that was also on the first day of the week. Now, number five, which is slide number three, the disciples came together for communion on the first day of the week. In Acts 20, verse 6, it says, "And we sailed away from Philippi after the days of unleavened bread, and came unto them to Troas in 5 days, where we abode 7 days." Likely, being that he left on a Monday, they would have gotten there probably on a Tuesday, the previous Tuesday. Upon the first day of the week, when the disciples came together to break bread, Paul preached unto them. Now, what can we know from this? They did not have a Saturday meeting. Okay? Mm-hmm. They did not have a seventh-day Sabbath meeting. Nothing is mentioned about a seventh-day Sabbath or a meeting or anything. You say, well, Paul went to the synagogues on the Sabbath. Paul was evangelizing to the Jew first and also to the Gentile, and Paul was a Jew. Okay? But the Christian church, the great memorial day of Christendom, is the resurrection day, the triumphal entry day, the Pentecost day. All right? And it's undeniable. Now, and those, by the way, well, we'll get there in a minute. I don't want to get ahead of myself. They did not have a meeting on the seventh day Sabbath. They did have a meeting on the first day of the week. Likely many of the disciples had to work. They were in the Roman Empire. Okay? And so even though the Jews likely were able to rest on the Sabbath because they had their own economy and they weren't necessarily working for Romans, all right? But the Christians oftentimes were working for Romans, and they didn't say, hey, by the way, I became a Christian, I want Sunday off. No, that didn't work. Becoming a Christian was illegal. So likely their meeting was in the evening because they had to work during the day. Paul waited until after the Lord's Day meeting to begin his journey on Monday. This is obvious from the passage, okay? Number six, Paul admonishes the churches to take up their collection when they meet on the first day of the week. In 1 Corinthians 16:1, "Now concerning the collection for the saints, as I have given order to the churches of Galatia." Notice something that a lot of people miss. There's not such a thing as the church of Galatia. Galatia was a region. There were churches in Galatia, all right? Not just one. It was a region. So He gave order to the churches of Galatia, even so do ye. Upon the first day of the week, let every one of you lay by him in store, as God hath prospered him, that there be no gatherings when I come. What was the purpose? That there be no collections when I come. I want all the collecting to be done. So people who say, well, this lay by in store was just everybody putting aside personally, and why? So when Paul came, you could all collect it? That was the purpose. We didn't want collections when he came. He wanted it to already be collected and gathered and stored up and ready. All right? Also, as God has prospered him refers to the previous week. So why would they be doing this on the first day of the week if yesterday was the meeting? That don't make any sense. No, they laid by them in store as God had prospered them the previous week, and they brought it to the collection on Sunday, when they met on Sunday. If they had just all set by them individually, then like I said, when Paul came, they would have to bring it all and gather it. He said that there'd be no gatherings when I come. It should already be done. And so the obvious and most common sense situation is that, yes, they met together. The people met together on the first day of the week. It was the Lord's Day. It was a memorial day of the resurrection. It was a memorial day of Pentecost. It was the day they had been meeting with the Lord Jesus Christ. Those 40 days when he met with them, likely he met with them every Lord's Day, just like he started out to do. So they brought they took up their offerings also on the first day of the week. Now, slide 4. Number 7, we find the last of the 7 basic points of evidence in the New Testament. John was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. Where did that term come from? The Lord's day. Well, we already said the Lord's Supper is the only other place that word is used. But in Psalm 118, this is the day which the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, is prophetic. This was the last psalm of the Hallel that they said every Passover. And there's a context here, all right? In verse 19, it says, open to me the gates of righteousness, basically the gates of salvation, the gates of justification. I will go into them, and I will praise the Lord. This gate of the Lord, into which the righteous shall enter, I will praise thee, for thou hast heard me and art become my salvation. What's the next verse? The stone which the builders refused is become the headstone of the corner. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. That's the context. For this is the day which the Lord hath made. We're talking about redemption. We're talking about salvation. Okay? Jesus used this verse in Matthew 21:38. After the parable of the vineyard, he sent his son. They said, come, let us kill him, seize on the inheritance. And they caught him and cast him out of the vineyard and slew him. When the Lord thereof of the vineyard cometh, what will he do unto those husbandmen? They say unto him, he will miserably destroy those wicked men and will let out his vineyard unto other husbandmen, which shall render him the fruits in his seasons. Jesus saith unto them, did ye never read in the scripture, the stone which the builders rejected, the same has become the head of the corner. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore say I unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you and given to a nation, bringing forth the fruits thereof. And then in Acts 4, the apostles are speaking to the Sanhedrin. Be it known unto you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you whole. This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which has become the head of the corner. And when did that happen? On the resurrection day. He became the head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. So the last psalm of the great Hallel that they sang at the feasts, and especially at the Passover, includes this messianic prophecy that's plain as day, all right? Slide number 5, verse 24. Right after, this is the Lord's doing, it is marvelous in our eyes. Verse 24 says, this is the day. which the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. What is the day that the Lord has made? When the stone that the builders rejected is made the head of the corner. This is the Lord's day, the day the Lord has made.
Right.
Psalm 118:25, the next verse. Save now, I beseech thee. That word is Hosanna. It's actually Hoshiana. All right? It means save now, we beseech thee. O Lord, O Lord, I beseech thee, send now prosperity. Save now, I beseech thee, and send now prosperity are both a form of the word Hoshiana, which we get our word Hosanna. All right? They sung this at tabernacles while they walked around the altar with palm branches and other branches in their hands. For 7 days, they would walk around the altar once. And on the seventh day, they would walk around it seven times, kind of like Joshua around Jericho. But they would sing these hallels, and they would say Hosanna and talk and look forward to their Messiah. It says here, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Everybody knew that was talking about the Messiah. We have blessed you out of the house of the Lord. God is the Lord, which has showed us light. Bind the sacrifice with cords, even under the horns of the altar. Thou art my God, and I will praise thee. Thou art my God, I will exalt thee. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. Now, when Jesus was riding down from the Mount of Olives on the donkey, what did they cry? Hosanna to the Son of David. Why? They believed he was the Messiah. That's why. And they knew this was a messianic prophecy. Mm-hmm. And so they're saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. In Mark 11:9, and they that went before and they that followed cried, saying, Hosanna, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. The people knew how to apply the psalm, right? This was a great thing. Now, you say, what about the bind the sacrifice with cords even under the horns of the altar? Well, when it came time for the sin offering, the first thing you do is bind the lamb. The last thing you do is apply the blood to the horns of the altar. Okay? Even unto the horns of the altar is obviously saying that we're going to follow through with the entire process, and we're talking about offering the sin offering. So, this whole thing is a prophetic psalm about Messiah, the ultimate atonement, the day that the Lord has made. Mm-hmm. All right? So in the early church, when it said, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, they knew what the Lord's day was. There was no doubt. You say, well, Brother Mark, what about the Sabbath? Obviously, this is a great memorial day of the new covenant. What about the Sabbath? Well, we'll get there in just a minute. In slide 5.5, one of the earliest extra-biblical references to Christianity is Governor Pliny, okay? Governor Pliny was governor of Bithynia in Asia Minor in AD 110 to 113. In AD 112, he writes to Trajan. He's unfamiliar in dealing with these Christians. And you can read the whole letter. You can go online and find it easily. Pliny's letter, it's there. And Trajan's response is also there. But he says, I've never before had in court and adjudicated Christians. It was kind of a new thing to him. He had just become the governor. It's like, what do I do with these Christians? And they were obviously quite numerous at the time, because he mentions that the temples had been more or less deserted, and nobody was buying the sacrificial animals and whatnot. And he was actually encouraged because of his persecution, more and more people were going back to the temple, and there were actually more people buying sacrificial animals. And so he felt like he was reforming the society there. But in persecuting and interrogating the Christians, there were some what happened was, when he started doing this, suddenly there was a letter, an informant, who had a whole list of names of people that they were turning in as Christians. Some of them said, yeah, I was at one time, but it's been 3 or 4 years. Some of them said as many as 25 years ago. It's in this letter. 25 years ago gets right back in the first century there, doesn't it? And there were Christians practicing and evangelizing in Bithynia on the Black Sea. So anyways, The ones who said, yeah, we used to be Christians, but we're not Christians anymore. And here it says, they asserted, however, these ones who said we're not Christians anymore, we used to be. They asserted, however, that the sum and substance of their fault when they were Christians. And a lot of them said, we stopped being Christians when you passed edicts against it. In other words, we were going along with it, but when we saw it was going to be persecuted, we backed away. And when you outlawed it, we stopped doing it. But they said the sum and substance of their fault as Christians or error had been that they were accustomed to meet on a fixed day before dawn and sing responsively a hymn to Christ as to a God. All right? And this was what they were basically saying, yeah, we used to be with those people, we're not anymore, but this is all they do. This is in their secret meetings that the government was so worried about. He said, this is all they do in their secret meetings. And to bind themselves by oath, not binding themselves to do a crime, but to not commit fraud, theft, adultery, not falsify their trust, nor to refuse to return a trust when called upon to do so. When this was over, it was their custom to depart and to assemble again to partake of food, but ordinary and innocent food. And so these people who had apostatized or maybe just came along for a while and then left testified that the Christians aren't doing anything wrong. What they're doing is noble and just. And so Pliny is reporting all this to Trajan and saying, what do I do with these people? But a fixed day. What day was that? There's no doubt. It wasn't 2 days. It was a day a week where they met, and early morning they sung a hymn to Christ as to God. Why early morning before dawn? Likely they had to go to work, just like why Paul had the other meeting at the evening. A lot of these were Roman slaves and Roman servants and poor farmers out there in the day, and oftentimes they would work for somebody else. They didn't change the Sabbath to Sunday. There's no basis for that whatsoever. Right. There's a holy memorial day for Christianity that the Lord has made. If we can abstain from work, we should. If we can abstain from other pursuits, we ought to give this day to honor the Lord. But it's not the same as the Sabbath laws given to Israel. And we'll cover that in a second. So, number 6. All the early church quotes here, the first few here, are, if John died in 98 AD, the previous quotes are within 42 years of his death, okay? In the same part of the country, by the way. Wherefore also we keep the eighth day with joyfulness, the day also on which Jesus rose from the dead. Barnabas, this was likely not the same Barnabas that we read about in Scripture. It was another Barnabas, probably a Gentile writer. But every Lord's day, gather yourselves together and break bread and give thanksgiving after having confessed your transgressions, so that your sacrifice may be pure. That's the Didache, which was, some people say, in the first century. I don't believe it was. I think it was early second century for a number of reasons, but nobody knows exactly. Sure, they just know it was very early. And it was basically a church standard, a rule of church discipline, and this is what it said to do. Ignatius, who was the second bishop of Antioch in Syria, where the Christians were first called Christians, Ignatius says, no longer observing the Sabbath, but living in the observance of the Lord's day. Justin Martyr, 140 AD, on the day called Sunday, all who live in cities or in the country gather together to one place, and the memoirs of the apostles or the writings of the prophets are read. But Sunday is the day on which we all hold our common assembly, because it is the first day on which God made the world, and Jesus Christ our Savior rose from the dead on that same day. Then in 195 AD, Clement of Alexandria also says the same thing, that according to the gospel, a person keeps the Lord's day. Obviously, the term the Lord's day unanimously is applied to the first day of the week, Sunday. Okay, you will not find in Christendom at this time the Lord's day being applied to the Sabbath by any Christian writers. So what about the Sabbath? Number 7 slide. To whom was the Sabbath given And what was the purpose of the Sabbath? What does the Bible itself say? Well, the first mention of the Sabbath is 2,500 years after creation. Genesis was written by Moses 2,500 years after creation. In Exodus 16:23, this is the first mention. And he said unto them, "This is that which the Lord has said. Tomorrow is the rest of the holy Sabbath unto the Lord. Bake that which ye will bake today, and seethe that ye will seethe, and that which remaineth over, lay up for you to be kept until the morning." The Lord at this same time gave them a new beginning of months, a new year, okay? When we already read that. In Deuteronomy 5, in looking back from the Deuteronomy perspective, after the 40 years, Deuteronomy, they're rehearsing the law before they go into Canaan after the previous generation died off. And Moses called all Israel and said unto them, "Hear, O Israel, the statutes and judgments which I speak in your ears this day, that ye may learn them and keep and do them. The Lord our God made a covenant with us, with Israel, in Horeb," that's Mount Sinai. "The Lord made not this covenant with our fathers," previous to the coming out of Egypt, obviously, "but with us, even us, who are all of us here alive this day." Then verse 12, "Keep the Sabbath day to sanctify it, as the Lord thy God hath commanded thee. 6 days thou shalt labor and do all thy work, but the seventh is the Sabbath." The word Sabbath, by the way, simply means rest. That's all it means. "Is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, nor thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thine ox, nor thine ass, nor any of thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates, that thy manservant and maidservant may rest as well as thou, and remember that thou wast a servant in the land of Egypt, and that the Lord thy God brought thee out thence through a mighty hand and by a stretched out arm. Therefore, the Lord thy God commanded thee to keep the Sabbath day." The Sabbath was given to Israel. Even though it was based on the fact that God rested the seventh day, it had never been implemented until now, and it was given because they were bought out from being slaves, and they were able to rest and remember that God gave them this rest because they were brought out of Egypt. And it was never instituted prior to this, as far as the Bible says, okay? Now, in Ezekiel 20, verse 10, God says, "Wherefore I caused them to go forth out of the land of Egypt and brought them into the wilderness, and I gave them my statutes and showed them my judgments, which is if a man do, he shall even live in them. Moreover also, I gave them my Sabbaths to be a sign between me and them, that they might know that I am the Lord that sanctify them." In Nehemiah 9:13, "Thou camest down also upon Mount Sinai and spake with them from heaven and gavest them right judgments and true laws, good statutes and commandments, and madest known unto them thy holy Sabbath, and commandest them precepts, statutes, and laws by the hand of Moses thy servant." Okay? So this was a part of the old covenant, the covenant with Israel as a nation. We'll see that more as we go along. Turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 3. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Because it was said that God rested the seventh day in Genesis, people believe, well, he instituted the Sabbath right there. That was not written, and it was not instituted at that time. It was used as a basis for God instituting the Sabbath in his covenant with Israel. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3, the Apostle Paul is writing here, and we'll begin verse 3, "For as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but in fleshy tables of the heart." Okay, we got a contrast beginning in this chapter between tables of stone and written on the heart. "And such trust have we through Christ to Godward. Not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything as of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God, who also hath made us able ministers of the new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life." Obviously, the new covenant is a covenant, not New Testament scriptures. Don't get that confused. We're not talking about New Testament scriptures. We're talking about the new covenant. The Jews who believed in Jesus for the first 12 years after the resurrection were in the new covenant, but the only scriptures they had was the Old Testament or Old Covenant scriptures, okay? So don't just jump there in your mind. We're talking about the difference between that which is written on stones, the letter, versus the spiritual fulfillment of God writing his law in our hearts, regeneration, the actual meaning of it all. Not just the letter given on Sinai, but the meaning of it all, what it really meant and what it pointed to, all right? The letter alone killeth. The blood of bulls and goats can't take away sin. The plumb line only condemns you. If they can't take away sin, they are Hagar, which refers to Sinai, which is in bondage, her and her children, which is earthly Jerusalem, the earthly priesthood. Okay, they're in debt. They're in bondage. So it killeth. There's no redemption there. But the new covenant is Sarah, who is a free woman, who can give liberty to her children, which is also the heavenly Jerusalem, which is the heavenly priesthood, which can pay for sin, and there is redemption there. Mm-hmm. All right? That's what the comparison is. But if the ministration of death, in other words, the old covenant, which was the type and shadow but could not save, written and engraven in stones is a clear delineation of what we're talking about. If that was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, how shall not the ministration of the Spirit, the new covenant, the redemption, justification be rather glorious? For if the ministration of condemnation be glory, which was basically a plumb line and the blood of bulls and goats and all this that could not redeem, much more doth the ministration of justification exceed in glory. So we're comparing the old covenant with the new covenant, the earthly priesthood with the heavenly priesthood. All right? We're talking about the administration of the type, the plumb line, which could only kill. And we're comparing it to the new covenant, Christ, the Lamb of God, the heavenly priesthood, which it can save. And it only can save. There's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. That's what we're talking about. Okay? For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect by reason of the glory that excelleth. For if that which is done away was glorious, much more that which remaineth is glorious. Seeing that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech, and not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. Now, turn to Hebrews chapter 8. We're not talking about God's morality being abolished. We're not talking about God's ethics being abolished. We're talking about a covenant with a nation that is abolished, okay? And a new covenant, which is with a remnant of believers, with Christ's disciples, and it's with the house of Israel, but it's with the house of Israel that believed in the Messiah. The other branches were cut off. So we have a house of Israel, a covenant made with them, not so much the nation, the political situation, but the believers in the Messiah. Right. And then the Gentiles are grafted into this, okay? Mm-hmm. So don't get confused. Now, in Hebrews chapter 8, he's talking about, in verse 10, "For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord, I will put my laws in their mind and write them in their hearts, and I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people." Obviously, that was for those who accepted it. He's not going to force his law on your mind and your heart. Those who came to God wanting his law on their heart and mind, okay, those were the ones he made a covenant with. And Christ was the Word in the flesh. So we saw the Word of God living and breathing. We saw God's law, God's Word, God's will, the best representation of God ever. We saw him lay down his life, resurrect from the dead. He became the Lamb of God to save us. If that doesn't write God's law on your heart, by seeing God become flesh, the law living and breathing and dying for you, nothing will. Okay, there was a lot going on here that wrote this law, this manifestation of God, his ways, his love, his ethics, wrote that in our hearts because we saw it walking around. We touched it, they said, John, 1 John 1, that which we have handled, the life, it was manifested. We've seen it. We've touched it. He died on the cross for us. He rose from the dead. All of that is taking what was written on the stones and should be burning it on your heart. That's the idea. Now, and they shall not, verse 11, and they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for all shall know me. All those in this covenant are going to be born again believers, disciples of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. All right? For they all shall know me from the least to the greatest. For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and iniquities will I remember no more, because they are under the priesthood of Christ. In that he saith a new covenant, he hath made the first old. Now that which decayeth and waxeth old is ready to vanish away. This was written in AD 64. 6 more years, and it vanished away. It became impossible to live by that covenant. Unless you innovate the way the Jews do, contrary to the Torah, which is not okay. Obviously, God made it impossible for us to live by the old covenant, for the Jews to. I'm a Gentile. But for the Jews to live by the old covenant. Because he gave them 40 years of respite, 40 years of evangelism. It was decaying and waxing old, and then it vanished away. Okay, it was abolished, it vanished away, it was done away. Now, the Sabbath was a part of that covenant. All right? Okay, so keep that in mind. And because it was soon to vanish away, we have in Acts 10, slide number 8, I'm not going to go through all the scriptures. In Acts 10, which is 12 years after the resurrection, we have God talking to Peter through a vision, talking to Cornelius, a Gentile, and bringing them together. And then God, in the witness of 7 Jews, God poured out his spirit upon Cornelius before he was circumcised, before he had entered the old covenant. Okay? He was a Gentile. He remained a Gentile. What was God saying to them? Well, if you go to Acts chapter 11, we'll look at that real quick. Peter comes back and he goes to the church at Jerusalem where James is bishop. In chapter 11, verse 1, and the apostles and brethren that were in Judea heard that the Gentiles had also received the word of God. And when Peter was come up to Jerusalem, they that were of the circumcision contended with him. These were circumcised Jews. They were believers. But they saying, thou wentest into men uncircumcised and didst eat with them. Now, is this just a sect of Christianity that was still hanging on to the old? No, because Peter said to Cornelius, he said, you know that it is an unlawful thing for one that is a Jew, a man that is a Jew, to keep company or come unto one of another nation, but God has showed me that I should not call any man common or unclean. Peter believed it too. Mm-hmm. Okay? So this wasn't just some sect of Jerusalem, the circumcision party, who had a problem with it. All Jews were living by the law of God. Okay? So for Peter to do this required a vision. But it says here, Peter rehearsed the matter from the beginning and expounded it by order unto them, saying, I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance I saw a vision, and that vessel let down. We'll go on down. Verse 12, after this vision, and the Spirit bade me go with them, nothing doubting. Moreover, these 6 brethren accompanied me, and we entered into the man's house. And he showed us how he had seen an angel in his house, which stood and said unto him, send men to Joppa and call for Simon, whose surname is Peter, who shall tell thee words whereby thou and all thy house shall be saved. You can come into the new covenant. These men were Gentiles, and they had not joined into the old covenant, but they did worship as proselytes of the gate. They were worshiping God and giving alms. His alms had come up for memorial before God. He was praying at the hour of prayer. But he was not in covenant. And Peter says, as I began to speak, the Holy Ghost fell on them as on us at the beginning. Then remembered I the word of the Lord, how he had said, John indeed baptized with water, but you should be baptized with the Holy Ghost. For as much then as God gave them, Gentiles, the like gift as he did unto us who believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, what was I that I should withstand God? When they heard these things, they, the Jews in Jerusalem, who were fully obeying God's law, who were who had never thought that the gospel would go to Gentiles, who were only evangelizing Jews, okay? When they heard these things, they held their peace and glorified God, saying, then hath God also to the Gentiles granted repentance unto life. And some people say, that's Calvinism. God made him believe. No, no. A Gentile who had repented prior to this could not come unto life without becoming a Jew. Okay? So now, the Gentiles, as Gentiles, the Gentiles not being converted to Jews, but Gentiles remaining Gentiles can repent before God and come into the new covenant. This was AD 42. God knew that in AD 70, he's going to put a stop to it. It was going to wax old and vanish away. It was going to be abolished. So why bring the Gentiles into it? Instead, he helped the Jews to prepare for the abolishing of the old covenant in AD 70 by grafting in Gentiles, godly Gentiles. They began evangelizing Gentiles. They could eat with them. When I'm saying eat with them, I mean have communion with them. They could actually be in the same house together, have a meal together. It doesn't mean the Jews began eating pork, okay? But they could actually sit down with these Gentiles and fellowship and call them brethren. Well, in AD 70, that was a very important step in there in the development, because now all their Jewishness has basically come to naught. No priesthood, no temple, okay? It was just crushed. And so they continued on. And it was also probably important to some degree to distance themselves from the Jews who rebelled against Rome. We're Christians. We're not one of them. So by giving them a new name, a new day of worship, and so forth, the Lord was drawing them out. And then he destroyed, in a great way, that which he drew them out of. So it's good to remember all this history as we go along. So understand that in Acts 10, 11, and then in 15, and then in 21, we've got this situation where the Gentiles were not being converted to Judaism. They were being grafted in. From the time that Abraham was circumcised unto Cornelius, Gentiles, if they wanted to be in covenant with God, got circumcised. After Moses, they came under the covenant with Moses, the Mosaic covenant. But now a Gentile comes to God through Jesus Christ, the heavenly priesthood. None of these earthly covenants are hindering him. Okay, prior to this, he had to join in a present operating covenant. And the Judaizers do everything they can to confuse that and shade that, as though Acts 10, 11, and 15 are dealing with conversion of Gentiles. Not so. If they were dealing with conversion of Gentiles, it would be the norm. Mm-hmm. Nothing new. Right. Conversion of Gentiles was nothing new. The Ethiopian eunuch was a proselyte to Judaism, okay? In fact, on the day of Pentecost, it said there were proselytes. There were people from every nation under heaven. And so it's very clear this was nothing new. Now, in Acts 21, verse 20, it's very important. This is 29 years after Pentecost, after the resurrection, okay? AD 59. And when they heard it, they glorified the Lord and said unto him, thou seest, brother, how many thousands of Jews there are which believe, and they're all zealous of the law. These are all Jewish believers in Christ. And they are informed of thee that thou teachest all the Jews which are among the Gentiles to forsake Moses, saying they ought not to circumcise their children, neither to walk after the customs. In other words, the Christian Jews in Jerusalem had heard rumors that Paul is telling Jewish people out in the Gentile nations to forsake Moses and not to walk according to Jewishness or Judaism. That wasn't true. He was telling Gentiles they didn't have to. Okay, so verse 23. Do therefore this that we say to thee, that all and all may know that those things whereof they were informed concerning thee are nothing. They're not true. But that thou thyself also walkest orderly and keepest the law. As touching the Gentiles which believe, we have written and concluded that they observe no such thing. That's how plain does it have to get? Save only that they keep themselves from things offered to idols and from blood and from strangled and from fornication. In the Galatians, Paul clearly says that the law was 430 years after Abraham's circumcision and promises of God. It was added because of transgression, till the seed should come to whom the promise was made. That's why the law, Moses' law, the covenant, speaking of the whole thing, was given to preserve the nation and prepare for the coming seed, the Messiah. But in Galatians, he also says, he's concerned because you Gentiles, when you didn't know God and you were worshiping idols, you did service unto them which are by nature no gods. You were worshiping idols. But now, after you've known God, you become a Christian, you've known God through Christ, or rather a known of God, how turn ye again to the weak and beggarly elements whereunto you desire to be in bondage? They weren't going back to idolatry. They had been converted from idolatry to Christianity, but now they were being drawn into Judaism by the Judaizers. Okay? And he says, you observe days and months and times and years. I'm afraid of you, lest I bestow upon you labor in vain. Now, in Colossians, we're dealing with the same subject. Okay? Colossians and Ephesians talk about the middle wall of partition has been broken down. The mystery that's been kept secret was that Gentile and Jew would be now in one body, one new man, so making peace. All right? The middle wall of partition being broken down. It didn't mean that Jews became Gentiles and Gentiles didn't become Jews, but the laws that kept them separate were taken down and they could fellowship together with Gentiles remaining Gentiles and Jews remaining Jews for this present time. All right? This is before AD 70. In 1 Corinthians 7, he says, are you called of God being circumcised? Don't become uncircumcised. In other words, you called as a Jew, you don't have to become a Gentile. Are you called in uncircumcision or Gentilism? Be not circumcised. Don't become a Jew. Let every man abide in the same calling wherein he was called. That was the present order before AD 70. He expected the Jews and the Gentiles to just get along and not judge one another. Romans 14 deals with that. But Colossians 2:16 is very clear. He's talking about this middle wall partition being broken down. Let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of an holy day or of the new moon or of the Sabbath days. We talk holy day is the yearly, we got the monthly, and we got the weekly. Okay? The yearly, the monthly, and the weekly. Can I prove that? I will. Because that is the order over and over that we find in the Old Testament. The Apostle Paul knew well the Tanakh, and he knew well these terms were clear to him. So slide number 9. 1 Chronicles 23:30. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but notice. the Sabbaths, new moons, and set feasts. 2 Chronicles 2:4. You get the lineup. Sabbaths, new moons, and solemn feasts. 2 Chronicles 8:13. Sabbaths, new moons, and solemn feasts. 2 Chronicles 20:31-3. Sabbath, new moons, and set feasts. You have in Ezekiel 45:17 the exact same lineup as in Colossians. Meat offerings, drink offerings, feasts, new moons, and Sabbaths. That's the exact same lineup. Paul said, don't let them judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of an holy day or the new moon or the Sabbath days. Okay? Nehemiah 10:33. You got the Sabbaths, the new moons, and the set feasts. These are the day, the weekly, the monthly, and the yearly, over and over and over. So when Paul uses this exact same lineup in Colossians, it means the exact same thing. Okay? So, in the first century, the Jews and the Christians had some dialogue. Slide number 10, We have Justin Martyr dialoguing with Trypho the Jew. This was a prominent Jew, and Justin Martyr was a prominent figure. We are actually having this dialogue at Ephesus in the very church where John lived and died about 42 years previous. So, Justin Martyr and Trypho the Jew are having a discussion, a dialogue, debate, if you will. And it's in the very church where John the Apostle preached, lived, and died 42 years ago. A lot of those people knew John, right? Okay, so there was a lot of accountability here. And so Justin, after naming Adam, Abel, Enoch, Lot, Melchizedek, he says, "Moreover, all those righteous men already mentioned, though they kept no Sabbaths, were pleasing to God." He also said, "For if there was no need of circumcision before Abraham, or of the observance of Sabbaths before Moses, no more need is here of them now. As then circumcision began with Abraham, and the Sabbaths with Moses." All right? Irenaeus, "Abraham believed God without circumcision and the Sabbath." Irenaeus, I always call him Irenaeus, but Irenaeus is how you say that. So, the old covenant was waxing old and vanished away. The Sabbath, the new moons, the feast was part of the old covenant. It was abolished, it was done away, it vanished away. We have a new covenant. The great memorial day of the new covenant is the day that Jesus rose from the dead. It was prefigured in the old covenant. Mm-hmm. Okay? The day he rose from the dead, the day of Pentecost, the triumphal entry, these were all preset and ordained of God to show the prominence of this wonderful day, the day that Jesus rode into Jerusalem, presenting himself as king. The day that he rose from the dead, the stone which the builders rejected became the headstone of the corner. This is the day which the Lord has made. This is the Lord's day. Just like the Lord's Supper is the Lord's Supper, it's the Lord's day. Now, before we close, I'm going to read you, or let you see here, just an extraction. D.M. Canwright of Grand Rapids, Michigan, back in 1887, was a prominent Seventh-day Adventist minister. In 1887, he renounced Seventh-day Adventism. And H.M. Riggle says this, that D.M. Canwright was for a number of years a very prominent minister and writer of the Adventist faith. At the time he renounced their doctrines in 1887, he held a number of the highest offices in the society and was no doubt one of the ablest ministers they had ever had. Okay? That's the opinion of H.M. Riggle. Now, D.M. Canwright says here, and I'll read it as you read it. "After keeping the seventh day and extensively advocating it for over a quarter of a century, I became satisfied that it was an error and that the blessing of God did not go with the keeping of it. Like thousands of others, when I embraced the seventh-day Sabbath, I thought that the argument was all on one side, so plain that 1 hour's reading ought to settle it, so clear that no man could reject the Sabbath and be honest. The only marvel to me was that everybody did not see and embrace it. But after keeping it 28 years, after having persuaded more than 1,000 others to keep it, after having read my Bible through verse by verse more than 20 times, after having scrutinized to the very best of my ability every text, line, and word in the Bible, having the remotest bearing upon the Sabbath question, after having looked up all these, both in the original and in many translations, after having searched in lexicons, concordances, commentaries, and dictionaries, after having read armfuls of books on both sides of the question, after having read every line in all the early church fathers upon this point, and having written several works in favor of the seventh day, which were satisfactory to my brethren, after having debated the question for more than 12 times, after seeing the fruits of keeping it and weighing all the evidence in the fear of God, I am fully settled in my own mind and convinced that the evidence is against the keeping of the seventh day." See, why did it take him so long to figure that out? Because he was converted into that church originally, taught that originally, and when you are indoctrinated in something, it's like all signs are made to point that direction. It's very hard to unravel yourself out of a web where you were raised and indoctrinated in that thinking. Okay? I know that personally. I was raised in the Baptist church. I was raised in eternal security. I was raised in their antinomian foolishness. And you say, well, yeah, we know that's wrong. But if you were raised in it, and everybody was speaking that, and all your friends believed it, and all the sermons you ever heard supported it, it's not so easy to convince yourself to leave it. Okay? And I understand that. That's why, how do you get Mennonites to give up their Marcionism? They're in denial. How do you get Baptists to give up their antinomianism? They're in denial. How do you get Calvinists to give up Calvinism? They're in denial. They're not going to give it up because it takes a redefining of so many terms. You got to think differently. But the Bible has enough clarity that if you only go on the evidence as it is presented, define, let the Bible define its terms, and stop and get rid of your prejudices, you'll be able to see. I've showed you this morning the basic evidence. It's there. That's the evidence. That's the case. All right? The Sabbath has no case. The testimony of the New Testament is all about the Lord's Day, and the only real mention of the Sabbath is in a lineup where you don't have to keep it anymore. It's part of that old covenant that is abolished and vanished away. Now, I didn't say the law of God vanished away. The law in the sense of the covenant. The law of Moses in the sense of the covenant. All right? If you had a marriage covenant and one of the partners ran off and that marriage was dissolved, there was divorce. That covenant was dissolved. And you got married again. Are you still the same person? Yeah. There's a lot of things in this marriage that are the same as was over there. Except that you're hoping that it'll go better because the other person won't run off or be unfaithful. God is still God. He made a covenant with the nation of Israel. Because they kept not his covenant, he disregarded them as well. He made a new covenant ratified by the blood of his own son. Ratified a new covenant with new parameters, with new apparatus. But it's the same God, the same plumb line, the same holiness, the same ethics. It's a new covenant arrangement. Let's stand together. That makes sense to you? Anybody have a question? So no, Sunday is not the Christian Sabbath. Unless you are using the term Sabbath as equal with Holy Day or Memorial Day, then Sunday is the Christian Memorial Day. Sunday is the Christian Holy Day. The laws of Sabbath are not placed upon Sunday. Okay? Should we reverence the day? Yes. Should we go about and live just like we always do? No. There needs to be a reverence there. There needs to be an observance there. But to go back to Sabbath laws to support it, you might as well go back to all the Sabbath laws and obey all the Sabbath laws, or don't bring them up, right? Okay, no thoughts, no questions?
Hear your thoughts on what a Jew today should do concerning the Sabbath, being that they can't keep so many of the feasts. Are they still obligated to the Sabbath, or?
If I met a Jewish person, I would take him to Romans 14. One esteemeth one day above another, another esteemeth every day. Esteemeth every day. Not the idea is one makes one day holy above the others. The other one says every day is holy unto the Lord. Okay? That's what the translation should be saying. Not that we believe that every day is common. So I would tell them, look, the old covenant is abolished. You are not obligated to that covenant. However, because that's not spelled out super clear and you may still feel an obligation before the Lord because are you circumcised? Have you been called in circumcision? Be not uncircumcised. Okay? Did that go past AD 70? It's hard to tell. It's hard to know for sure whether there was any obligation past AD 70. If that old covenant was abolished, done away, and vanished away, I would say you've got good ground for saying I'm not obligated to a covenant, okay? But if someone still had a conscience about it, I'd say rest on Saturday. But obviously, you need to come and worship on Sunday. Sunday is the Lord's Day. If you want to rest on Saturday, go ahead. Good question. Anything else? Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer.